Hi, this is Gary with MacMOST.com. In this episode, let's check out 10 small but useful features of macOS Catalina that you should try right away. MacMOST is brought to you thanks to a great group of supporters. Go to MacMOST.com/Patreon. There you could read more about it, join us, and get exclusive content. So there are a lot of big new changes in macOS Catalina, but like every macOS update, there are also all these small little useful things that you should know about. So let's take a look at 10 features that I think you'll find very useful. So let's start off by looking at something that's rarely mentioned, but you're bound to notice it pretty quickly when you upgrade to Catalina. The green button on all windows, you can use that to go full screen, and you can also use that to go into split screen view. But now with Catalina, it's a little more obvious what it does, because if you hover your cursor over it, you get a little menu here that gives you all of the options. So instead of having to kind of guess and remember how it works, you can just hover over it and select one of these. Go full screen or tile to one side and then select another app there for the other side. Likewise, when you're in full screen mode, if you hover over it, you'll see exit full screen. Also, if you have an iPad nearby that's using iOS 13 and the same Apple ID as your Mac, you'll get the option here to use the new sidecar feature. Now, dark mode isn't new for Catalina, but there is a new feature. If you go to System Preferences and then General, you have not only light and dark modes that you can switch between, but a new auto mode. And if you use that, then at night it will switch to dark mode automatically and then back to light mode in the morning. There are a couple minor new things in the Mail app, but the one that I like the most is the ability to easily block a sender. So if you're getting something from a company and they just won't stop even after you're unsubscribed, you can click on their email address here and then there's block contact. And you'll see this message block from the sender up here and a shortcut to the preferences. You can also just go to Mail Preferences and then look under Junk Mail. And there's a tab here for blocked. And here you can see that it's enabled. There's that email address in the list. And you can add some manually and remove any that you want and determine what happens when you get an email message from someone in this list. This isn't really useful for spam because spam's always going to come from some random address and sometimes from a legitimate address that they're faking. So this can't really be used for junk mail filtering, but it is useful when you want to block a real person or a real company from sending you an email because they just won't stop. So let's go back into System Preferences here, and there are a lot of new options under Accessibility, but a couple small ones that haven't gotten talked about much are Zoom Style and Hover Text. Zoom Style isn't new. You were always able to go to split screen and picture in picture for it. What's new is full screen, and this works if you have more than one screen attached to your Mac. So a second screen attached to your MacBook, or you just have multiple screens attached to your desktop. If you choose full screen, then you can choose a display. Then the second display acts as a zoom for the primary display. Hover Text is really cool. If you turn it on and then hold the Command key down as you move over text, the text will enlarge. Just about any text will enlarge. So you can be in the Finder here now and you could look at all this different text. You could be in all sorts of different apps and read the text in all sorts of different places. Just by holding the Command key down when you have this option turned on, you could also go to Options here and change the modifier, change the location of the text, the size of it, and what font is used. Also in Accessibility under Display, you now have the option to use color filters and tint your entire display. So you can enable these color filters, decide what you want to use here, use color tint, and pick a color and the intensity for it, and it will tint the display. It's something you actually see live on your physical display. Now, one of the new things in QuickTime Player is the ability to go picture in picture with QuickTime Player. So you're watching any video that you've opened in the QuickTime Player. You've got this picture in picture button here, and now you can be viewing it in any corner of the screen. You can stretch it a little bit to make it bigger or smaller, and then you can exit and go back to the regular view in QuickTime like that. In addition, you've got picture in picture in Safari. Now you had it before, but the problem was it worked differently for different types of videos. For YouTube, for a QuickTime video embedded in a page, for all sorts of different things, it worked in different ways. Now if you're playing video in a page and you actually get the little speaker icon there, you can click and hold that speaker icon and use that for picture-in-picture in a consistent way. So now you can see I've got it here and I can exit and go back to the web page like that. Now while we're in Safari, there's a cool new feature in the address bar here. Of course you can search the web, you can enter web page addresses and do all sorts of things here. But a new thing is to be able to find tabs. So if you've got like 30 tabs open, this will be really useful for you because you can type something and one of the results you'll get is switch to tab. So you can do this all with the keyboard. You can do Command L to go to the address bar, type something, arrow down and hit return and it jumps to that tab. So not a big deal for these four tabs, but if you're one of those people that has tons of tabs open, it'll be easy to switch to it. And you kind of get reminded that you have it open as well. So you go to a site like this and you'll see switch to tab here and it'll be like, oh yeah, I've got a tab for that website already open. So one last little tip here that not many people are mentioning. If you're using iCloud Drive and you have Optimize turned on, then you may have some documents that have been downloaded to your Mac, like these here, and then some that aren't. And you can see this little cloud icon there saying this one's in the cloud. Now, if you have a large file and you want to get it off your drive, you can control click on it and there's a new option called Remove Download. What this does is it forces the file off your drive, so it restores that space. Because it's in the cloud, you'll still see it here, and when you go to open it, you'll be able to just download it automatically and see it. You can also, of course, control click on it and use Download Now to grab it without even opening it. So really useful for those that are using the Optimize feature for iCloud Drive. And here's a bonus tip. In System Preferences, if you go to your Apple ID, then you can now see a list here at the bottom left of all the devices that have been set up with your Apple ID. And then you can select a device, get information about it, and remove it from the account if you no longer have it. Now remember, there are a lot of big new changes as well. We've looked at some in previous episodes, and we'll be looking at more, like all the new features of Notes and Reminders, in episodes to come. I publish new tutorials every weekday. Hit the subscribe button so you don't miss out. Then hit the little bell icon to get notifications for each new tutorial.